To the extent that artists struggle to express beauty in form and color and sound, to the extent that they write about man's struggle with nature or society or himself, to that extent they strike a responsive chord in all humanity. Art knows no national boundaries. Genius can speak in any tongue, and the entire world will hear it and listen. And I am certain that after the dust of centuries has passed over our cities, we too will be remembered, not for victories or defeats in battle or in politics, but for our contribution to the human spirit. If we can make our country one of the great schools of civilization, then on that achievement will surely rest our claim to the ultimate gratitude of mankind.
I think that's on, yeah. Good evening, everybody. I'm Darren Woods, General Director of Fort Worth Opera. Welcome to JFK, Five Decades of Progress. It is with great pleasure that we are celebrating the arts tonight and dedicating this night to the memory and the contribution of Ruth Carter Stevenson. Tonight, your moderator was supposed to be Mark Skorka of Opera America, but he was not able to come, so I will try to fill in for his rather large shoes and do the best as your moderator. We'll have a discussion on Kennedy's effect on the arts and also talk about the new opera JFK by David T. Little and Royce Vavrek, commissioned by Fort Worth Opera. I'll introduce our panelists one by one, and then we'll get started with the evening. Mark Gunderson is an architect in private practice in Fort Worth since 1985. He's past president of the Dallas Architectural Foundation and past president of AIA Fort Worth, where he's a recipient of the chapter's highest honor, the James R. Wooten Service Award. Mark has served on numerous regional architectural juries as well as lecturing on architecture at the Kimbell Art Museum, Modern Art Museum of Fort Worth, Dallas Museum of Art, National Sculpture Center, and many more. Please welcome Mark Gunderson. Dr. Andrew Walker is director of the Amon Carter Museum of American Art. Prior to joining the Carter, he was the assistant director for curatorial affairs and the curator of American art at the St. Louis Art Museum, a position he held for 6 years. Dr. Walker received his doctorate in art history from the University of Pennsylvania, supported by the Henry Luce Foundation, American Council of Learned Societies Dissertation Fellowship, and the Jacob Javits Fellowship with the U.S. Department of Education. Please welcome my friend Andrew Walker. Dr. George Shackleford is deputy director of the Kimbell Art Museum. Prior to his appointment here, he was chair of the Department of the Art of Europe and Solomon Curator of Modern Art at the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston, which he joined in January 1996. Prior to that, he was curator of European painting and sculpture at the Museum of Fine Arts in Houston. He received his PhD from Yale University in 1986. In 2005, he was elected a Chevalier of the Order of the Arts and Letters by the Republic of France. Please welcome George Shackleford. Royce Vavrek is an Alberta-born, Brooklyn-based librettist and lyricist known as an exemplary creator of operatic prose, the New York Times. He is the librettist of JFK. His collaborations with composer David T. Little has led Heidi Wilson of the Wall Street Journal to proclaim them one of the most exciting composer librettist teams working in opera today. Their first opera, Dog Days, had its world premiere at peak performances in Montclair, New Jersey, and subsequent performances in Fort Worth and Los Angeles. Other collaborations with the two are Am I Born for the Brooklyn Symphony and Finkensport, or the Finch Opera, for Bard Conservatory. Other recent collaborations are Song from the Uproar with Missy Mizzulli, and 27 with Ricky Ian Gordon. Royce is co-artistic director of the Coterie and holds a BFA in filmmaking creative writing from Concordia University and an MFA in musical theater writing from New York University. Please welcome Royce Vavrek. Royce and David have been our best friends for the past 4 years, and it's finally come to pass. Our next panelist is David T. Little, is one of the most imaginative young composers on the scene. His operas Soldier Song and Dog Days have been widely acclaimed, quote, proving beyond any doubt that opera has both a relevant present and a bright future by the New York Times. Recent upcoming works include Ghostlight, Ritual for Six Players for 8 Blackbird at the Kennedy Center, Charm, Baltimore Symphony, Marion Alsop conducting, and of course, the world premiere of JFK for Fort Worth Opera. He is a composer in residence at Opera Philadelphia and Music Theater Group, and the founding artistic director of the ensemble Newspeak. His music can be heard on New Amsterdam and Innovio labels. Please welcome our composer, David T. Little. Thank you so much, panel. Just to set the context a little bit, this is on the JFK Library Foundation page. The Kennedys made the arts a part of their life in the White House. JFK enjoyed literature and poetry, especially the work of Lord Byron and the American poet Robert Frost. Jackie Kennedy loved poetry as well and was also deeply committed to both the music and the visual arts. There's little evidence that JFK was particularly sophisticated about the arts. He read widely but never considered himself an intellectual or an original thinker. His musical taste ran from Broadway to Irish ballads rather than Mozart or Beethoven. Once asked about the president's musical tastes, the First Lady responded, his favorite piece was Hail to the Chief. However, JFK did understand the importance of what Theodore Roosevelt called the bully pulpit and was convinced that it was essential for the president to demonstrate a regard for and recognition of cultural and intellectual excellence. As a result, Kennedy eagerly accepted the idea of inviting Robert Frost to read a poem at the inauguration and also invite more than 50 other writers, painters, poets, and musicians to the ceremonies. At an April 1962 White House dinner for Nobel Prize winners, Kennedy delighted guests by calling them the most extraordinary collection of talent, of human knowledge, that has ever been gathered at the White House, with the possible exception of when Thomas Jefferson dined alone. The Kennedy support for the arts extended beyond contemporary artists to the next generation of Americans and included, for example, a series of concerts for young people at the White House, sponsored by the First Lady to encourage the study and performance of music by America's youth. And so I'm going to start with you, Mark. I'd like to ask you, in the spring of 1962, JFK created the position of Special Consultant on the Arts and Architecture. He recognized the role of the government in the arts was historically and constitutionally limited, but he wanted to have access to advice in those areas where public policy had an artistic dimension, such as the design of buildings. Can you tell us what was the effect of this consultant on architecture and art? Was it immediately felt, and did his death in 63 in any way diminish this push forward?
The effect was enormous. Thank you, Darren, and what a privilege to be here. I didn't realize anybody spoke as fast as I did, so I'll try. This is reassuring. And it's funny because I'm not used to using JFK as a filter on these things, and so it's been really enlightening to go backwards and see. Other people usually get the credit for the sort of contributions that he made along the way, but it's remarkable, and 54 years can easily be attributed to a few sentences, really, in a way, on his part. It's well known that at the inauguration in 1961, that he was disappointed in what Pennsylvania Avenue looked like and was worried that they'd be able to get consultants to the federal government with such a downtrodden condition in Washington, D.C. So he founded, as you say, the Ad Hoc Committee on Federal Office Space and had the prescience to put Daniel Patrick Moynihan, who was then the special assistant to the Secretary of Labor, as the chair for that committee. The General Services Administration, which is the entity within the federal government that looks over all federal construction, had really just been founded in 1949 at the same time that the White House was being completely rebuilt by Truman. It had almost fallen apart. And I have a habit, too, also of putting sort of the president and the first lady together almost as an entity because it's hard to pull them apart once you start looking at architectural and design issues. But so I would say Jack and Jackie in a funny kind of way. But that Moynihan managed by summer of 1962, and this is even after Jackie had done the restoration of the White House, the interiors and furnishings and so on, which she made that presentation Valentine's Day in 1962 while 80 million TV viewers watched her tour. Moynihan, in June of that year, there's less than 500 words in this little document that's called the Guiding Principles for Federal Architecture, but you could argue that every federal program that's come since architecturally is really germinated, the seed for it is within that text. And the founding sentence in a funny kind of way was John F. Kennedy quote from Pericles when he talked to the Athenians when he said, "We do not imitate, for we are the model to others." And Moynihan took that and extruded it to mean, he said that the committee is also of the opinion that the federal government, no less than other public and private organizations concerned with the construction of new buildings, should take advantage of the increasingly fruitful collaboration between architecture and the fine arts. And within three little paragraphs, that he's tackled the idea that the finest contemporary American architectural thought should be part of the federal building program. He understood that that's the face of the federal government to most citizens. Those spaces set the tone, that it should reflect regional architectural traditions, that fine art should be incorporated in it, emphasis on the work of living American architects, which was not necessarily a normal thing to governmental construction. More so, even in the first paragraph, the last sentence is that it should be accessible to the handicapped, which, you know, it took 30 years for the Americans with Disabilities Act to show up, but absolutely it would have taken much longer, I suspect, without that observation. He noted that there shouldn't be an official style, that design should flow from the architectural profession to the government and not vice versa, that architects should be given their professional reign in some way, and set up a program whereby distinguished architects were invited to be part of important commissions, not in-house architects, let's say, for the federal government, as it had been over time. And a third little piece, which is about landscape and siding and being careful about understanding context. Out of that, in just a few years, then you have, I think of the two LBJs, I think of Lyndon Baines and Lady Bird in the same sort of way as Jack and Jackie, but I think the assassination, back in a way to your question, galvanized that. I don't know how far it would have gone through LBJ's administration if LBJ had even made it to be president without the assassination. I don't know how far any of those initiatives would have traveled through time, but certainly the assassination galvanized those ideas, and you can see in a person like LBJ that his program in 1965, which you'll hear the echo in Lady Bird's program for Texas wildlife on highways, and so, wildflowers and so on the highway, is program for beautification of federal buildings. So he's playing that idea through. The next year, you have the National Historic Preservation Act, which is hugely important in taking care of historic buildings still. The National Environmental Policy Act came out 3 years later in 1969. You have the Art and Architecture Program is 1972. And probably most importantly at the moment would be the GSA has a design excellence program, which they created in 1994, in which they try to engage contemporary masters in architecture for important courthouses and federal projects around the country. It includes a design peer component, which I've been beneficiary of in a way as being a design peer on an FAA project here at Alliance that's not under construction yet, I don't think. A few years ago, but in any case, there's more programs still, and I won't go through them unless it comes up later, but in overview, I think you'd say that those few sentences, I think of it like Kennedy and Jackie and the First Lady having this capacity to inspire, to aspire, to cause people to try to reach further than they might normally reach. And I think it's true, if we come back to Lou Kahn and the Kimbell and so on, I think Kahn as an architect was that kind of architect as well, where a very few words could create a condition in which people aspired to do something better than the normal for that.
Thanks. Andrew, tonight we're celebrating and remembering Ruth Carter Stevenson and her contribution to that evening. And a lot of us do know what happened, but for those who don't, could you sort of tell us about Ruth's contribution that
day? Sure. You know, sitting in this auditorium, which is a spectacular architectural statement, not only what Mark was sharing, but I think about the impact that Ruth has had on this community. And in some ways, it's embodied even by the aspiration of the Kimbell Museum to add to this remarkable architectural landscape here in the Cultural District with this building. And I say it for this reason. How many of you knew Ruth or know of her tremendous impact? What's really remarkable are the people that helped her do what she did, and I'll get to it in a moment, around the visit that John and Jackie Kennedy had the night before here in Fort Worth before going fatefully to Dallas. That her commitment, Ruth's commitment to what that act symbolized, in my opinion, was something that she carried through her entire life and contributed to Fort Worth in ways that are incalculable, I think, in many respects. But the story went, basically, that when the word came out that John and Jackie, the president and the first lady, were going to be stopping in Fort Worth the night before, and then at breakfast the next morning before heading on to Dallas, word got out that the Hotel Texas, where they would be staying, the room was appropriately decorated in hotel chic. And one of the cultural leaders at the time, a man named Owen Day, thought that that was pretty abhorrent, that the president and first lady coming to our city would have to stay in a room that was pedestrian in a certain way. And so that began a process, and he reached out to another influential individual in Fort Worth at the time, Sam Canty, who immediately picked up the phone, as I understand it, and called Ruth. And she was completely on board that she would lead the charge to show in that room where John and Jackie Kennedy would be saying what the museums of Fort Worth and the cultural aspirations of Fort Worth represented. So in a matter of 5 days, a museum exhibition today takes about 5 years, these very determined leaders here in Fort Worth wanted to be hospitable to the president and first lady, even though in large measure there was a political divide. There wasn't a lot of agreement necessarily within that community, but they knew and they stood by the sense of decorum and graciousness that Fort Worth would show to any dignitary coming to our city. So that was one. And they gathered together, I think it was 16 works of art from two museums and five private collectors. And that body of work embodied five European works and the rest 11 American works. So it was broad-based. But my theory, as I've thought about this, because in a couple of years ago, in 2013, the museum at the Amon Carter partnered with the Dallas Museum of Art to put together a recapitulation, a retelling of this important moment that had gotten lost in history because of the fateful event that occurred the next day, this great demonstration. But aside from just graciousness, I think what Ruth was really doing was showing a blueprint for the aspirations, the cultural aspirations of this town, which led to, ultimately, the cultural district. I mean, think about it, and this is what amazes me when I really dug into this story, and having had the great benefit of knowing Ruth in her final few years, was she was 40 years old, a woman in Fort Worth, taking on and having just opened 2 years earlier this remarkable new museum in Fort Worth, really the first gutsy, independent institution at the top of the district at the time, or at Montgomery, as where it is today, of course, by a noted living architect and somebody who wasn't local, and not that that was a bad thing at the time, but showing the aspirations of what Fort Worth could represent. And so in these three rooms where these 16 works of art were, which were largely late 19th to the contemporary, were put, you saw the blueprint for what the cultural district could be. There was American art, a notable work by Charlie Russell, but the only Western work that was in all of these different rooms, in these three different rooms that the Kennedys would be occupying. There were works of the French Impressionists and Post-Impressionists, so there was an international framework, but also a framework that in a sense defined what the aspirations, the growing aspirations of that time of what would become the Kimbell. And then there were contemporary works. There were works by Franz Klein, by Mark Toby. These were artists who were at that moment the defining artists of their era. They were the Ellsworth Kelly, we might say today. Or the Jasper Johns of that time. And so there was no fear about showing the most contemporary work in the context of the works of the 20th century American and European that were also occupying those rooms. And so in a sense, that became the template, the sense of the aspirations for this city, embodied in this gesture of gratitude or and of graciousness to the president and first lady. And that's the one thing I would say Ruth always did, which was it seems just gracious on the surface, like, oh, that's so nice. But underneath of it, there's power and there's determination and there's vision. And that's really what I, you know, as I tell the story of what occurred that evening, that was Ruth's real dedication.
When I first met her, we'd wanted to do a program in the Carter, and there had, to my knowledge, to that point, never been an operatic performance in the Carter. So we arranged to put a Whistler thing on our drawing on our Bohem program, and so Ruth said yes, we could have a concert, a Bohem talk in there. And after saying no for a long time, and she was standing by me when Stephen Costello sang the first notes, and she said, nice acoustics. And that was just like, so. George, you had a really interesting observation about the Kennedys and sort of their interest in art and visual art, musical art, and where that sort of brought us to what it was like then and what it was now. Would you share some of those that you had?
One of the things that occurred to me when we were talking about the role of the Kennedys vis-a-vis the arts in our time now, and then the extraordinarily non-diverse group of us sitting here on the stage, is that the arts in Fort Worth are more than the institutions. Sure, the big museums that are here in this little corner of Fort Worth are critical, I think, to our, I guess, international reputation. But I think that one of the things that the Kennedys made possible was, or even promoted and asserted, was that the arts were meant to be part of everyone's experience, and that you know, if you were, it's fine if you were at the White House to listen to Pablo Casals play, or it would be fine if you were going to be the beneficiary of an NEA grant if you were an artist or a musician. It was also important that those efforts should have an effect on the grassroots of our country. Mm-hmm. And I think that when I'm somebody who was a kid when the Kennedys were in office, when Jack Kennedy was in office, and Jacqueline Kennedy was, in a sense, the public face of fine art in America, one of the leading faces for the whole notion of the visual arts, the performing arts in this country. And when I think now of how that has, what has come to pass 50 years later, when in this city, for instance, in addition to the sort of biggest cultural institutions, thinking only in the visual arts, there are our neighbors at the Fort Worth Community Arts Center here, which occupies the building that was before Ruth Stevenson, the museum in Fort Worth. The places, the two galleries at TCU, both Fort Worth Contemporary Arts and the Modi Gallery at the in the art building. Places like 414 and these the more, much more community-based centers. And then it's no longer the face of the visual arts in Fort Worth is no longer, frankly, Ted Pillsbury, George Shackleford, Andrew Walker, Mark Gunderson, et cetera. It is Cedric Huckabee and you know, a much broader and diverse group of people than would Devin Bolin, you know, at mm-hmm. TCU, you know, who are doing things that are all about, these are people who are from here and who have risen to a real national role of prominence and who are here and are here because they believe in this city.
It's true.
And that this happens all over America. And I think that we can't underestimate the role in that people like the Kennedys had 50 years ago, you know, again, when I was a kid, in making this seem great and even cool, that there should be something as open to everyone as a community arts center.
Yeah, it could be argued that we would not have, you know, 50 years ago, there were just a handful of regional opera companies, and now there are 170. And the grassroots stuff that's being done in New York and that's just, you know, like Beth Morrison projects, and it's astonishing what to this we've come. It's just really great.
I think one of the aspects that George touched on was the artists, and I see this across the country, are staying in their communities. They're not feeling compelled to go to a coast or, you know, to Chicago or wherever.
Mark, you had a small anecdote about maybe Louis Kahn and the Kennedys. You want to tell us that?
There's two or three, and I can't confirm one, so I won't say it. But basically, Lou Kahn's office was, as is well described by Rick Brown in his description of the interview for the Kimbell, was a sort of 24-hour-a-day disrepair. It was sandwiches and magazines laying around, students from all over the world trying to be part of his internationally recognized projects. And not the kind of place where you'd walk in the door and expect to see high-end business being done, but it was completely about architectural ideas. He would sleep on a board in his room for a couple hours at a time and so on. After the assassination, Jackie was interviewing architects for the Kennedy Library and visited Lou Kahn's office, as did Rick Brown, and it was on the fifth floor of a building there at 15th and Walnut in Pennsylvania. And it was in that usual state of disrepair. They were trying to put away cigarette butts and trying to clean up sandwiches off the floor because Jackie was coming. And as the anecdote goes, just like with Rick Brown, she was smitten with this conversation with Lou about architecture and about the qualities that a presidential library should have or could have, and left. She had advisors with her, and she left with the idea that that would be her choice for the architect for her for the Memorial Library. Her advisors got her outside and said, there is no way in the world that you're going to hire Lou Kahn to do the presidential library, that the business aspects of that weren't good, and the visual quality. So they had visited the I Am Pei office, and Pei, as you know, is just the impeccable, perfect, everything about his office might as well have been a piece of the East Wing in a way. And so he had even put out fresh flowers throughout the office and had put a special bouquet there in the entry hall to welcome Jackie when she got there. And so there's no question he's a remarkable candidate. He did a beautiful job with the library, but it, in a funny kind of way, you could say architecturally he was a second choice after the business terms ruled Lou out of it.
I'm glad we have our con, so that's good. George and Andrew, both, can you speak a little bit to about the pieces that were in there specifically? Was it really curated, or was it just what she could? I mean, my favorite picture of that whole getting together is her buckling the Picasso owl into the front of her station wagon.
True.
You know, it's for Fort Worth, and it's sort of iconic. But what impressionists were in there, and what Western paintings was in there, and were they? Did the Kennedys know right away, or did they recognize it the next? Laura has said they woke up the next morning and said, "Oh my gosh, there's great art in the hotel room."
Yeah, well, you know, I think it's very interesting when you look at the choice of what was there. Those of you who saw the exhibition either in Dallas or here at the Amon Carter will remember that there was a sort of a wide variety of things. Mm-hmm. Most of them were selected from people that Ruth could call and make the agreement on the phone without a letter being sent or a loan form being sent. I suspect it was mostly done with, if there was a hand receipt, I would be very surprised. It was just, come on, I'm coming in my station wagon. Can you send me your, you know, can you give me your Picasso?
Yeah.
Exactly. And so there was
and they said yes.
And they said yes, of course. Did you ever say no to her?
No.
No, I think not. And so, but for instance, you know, there was in the Dallas Museum of Art, and had been since the 1930s, a really, really major Monet, which at that point was certainly the most important Impressionist painting in North Texas, without any doubt. But that was, of course, not on the list of what could be borrowed for the Fort Worth night staying. It was not going to be a painting from Dallas. Instead, it was a fantastic Van Gogh that was her own. Mm-hmm. And I recently met the man who now owns that Van Gogh, who unfortunately would not lend it to Fort Worth. But it's a really beautiful painting, and it was in the Dallas exhibition. And I think I think the choice of things for Jackie's room, that was very, very francophilic, And the Van Gogh is just a perfect example of that, a very beautiful sort of impressionist Van Gogh before he gets to be the kind of tortured soul of the very last years of his career. And a beautiful picture of springtime, blooming trees, people walking in a garden. And Mrs. Kennedy's reputation for being a Francophile, a Francophone, being born with the name Jacqueline Bouvier, it predisposed her bedroom to be decorated in the French taste. What was around for the president was the manlier side of things, and obviously Russell, but also the great from the Fort Worth, then the Fort Worth Museum, what's now the modern. Then owned the painting of Aikens of Summertime of the Watering Hole, the wonderful swimming picture that is now in the Amon Carter, of course. And that was deemed appropriate for a man's room. Well, as everybody knows, or everybody who saw the show, the Secret Service deemed that the Impressionist bedroom was more secure than the swing hole bedroom. And so the president and first lady had to switch rooms, and the president woke up with Van Gogh and the the first lady with a passel of boys, naked boys. and which may in fact be the better way of looking at things anyway. So in any case, that statement of fact that there were that there were these undeniable masterpieces here in and that in one case they had been there forever. The first real owner of the watering hole was in the swimming hole was in fact the Fort Worth city institution, and that I think was enormous importance for the reputation of the city of Texas, of Fort Worth, Texas.
And Royce, I know that we brought this sort of the history of the opera. We were sitting in my office 4 years ago, the artistic team of Fort Worth Opera, and we said, it's the 70th anniversary of the company, it's the 10th anniversary of the festival in 2016. We want to do something really special. We want to find an international, a local story that will have international implications. And we thought about a lot of things, and finally Kurt Howard said, I think JFK spent the night in here in Fort Worth before he went to Dallas. And I said, oh, everybody would know that if that were true. And Google being your friend, we Googled it, and indeed it was true. And so we set about finding a composer and librettist, and I had met Royce, I met Royce right after that at the New Works Forum in the fall of 12, I believe, and liked his work, and we had lunch together, and I said, we got this crazy idea about doing an opera about JFK in Fort Worth, but I don't want to do the assassination, I want it just to take place in Fort Worth. And so then I came back in January, and that I met David T. Little 2 days later in a bar with Royce. And so then we came back in December and January, and they said, you know that crazy idea about JFK? We think that's a great idea, and we think that we should write it. And after a couple of martinis and a really good dinner, we decided that was a really good idea, and it's been a spectacular idea. So we brought them here to Fort Worth for 2 full weeks of research. They went to the stockyards, they went to the museums, they saw everything that we, Sixth Floor Museum, everything that we could show them. And I know that one of the first things that was really inspiring was the story of Ruth. And so do you want to talk about, Royce, how that sort of helped the story along?
Yeah, it was a really great way to start the conversation with I work with a dramaturg named Mike Cohen. And we sat down, and David and I had come up with a treatment that was very, a sort of a straightforward account of the hours that Jack and Jackie spent in Fort Worth. And we, after talking with David, we knew that we needed to find some sort of theatrical magic in the story. There had to be, it had to sort of transcend the basic plot points of what happened. And because they slept for most of the time, and there had to be something more dramatically interesting than snoring.
We slept,
snoring.
We ate breakfast, and we left, yeah.
And so the one thing, I remember William Madison, who was our researcher, he was really, really excited and sort of encouraged us to try to find a way to have Ruth's story be a huge and very integral part of the opera. And talking to my dramaturg, I wanted to take that one step forward. And I'm really obsessed with the idea that being in sharing space with art, whether it's visual art or music or dance or whatever, that it somehow informs our chemistry. And it makes us think and feel and do all, it makes us even more human in many ways. And so I wanted to find a way that the art in the room could sort of transform their experience. And so they became these portals into dreams. And I thought that dreams were a really exciting, dramatic vehicle in this, a potential vehicle in this opera. And so they truly did become these portals, these avenues into the subconscious, or Jack's preoccupation, or Jackie's preoccupation. And so that really, they became unbelievably important in the fabric of the opera that you will all see in about a month's time.
David, I listened to Soldier Song, some of your music before we talked about the commission and everything. And so I just found David's music had an energy to it that just said to me, John F. Kennedy. And so talk a little bit about your musical style and how you've gone from where you started to this grand opera that is about to be on stage in about a month.
Well, I started out, I have this sort of unusual musical upbringing, which is that I played in a fife and drum corps. So I was playing sort of colonial Revolutionary War music and Civil War music. I grew up in a family of amateur theater performers. My parents met doing West Side Story, and that was sort of very much in the air growing up, West Side Story and Camelot and all the sort of classical musicals. And then around the age of 12, I got really obsessed with death metal. and so somehow my musical language as a composer is this sort of combination of these things. And I think one of the things that you liked in Soldier Songs was this energy and this sort of rhythmic thing. So I'm a drummer. So rhythm is very important. And what's been interesting, and I think if you look at the operatic works I've written over the years, you can see that the voice becomes, well, my writing for the voice becomes friendlier the more I do it and the more I sort of fall in love with writing for singers. So the earlier works, pieces like Soldier Songs, well, Matt can tell you maybe after. He just sang Soldier Songs in Atlanta. This is a sort of friendlier material. But through all of this, what I've been drawn to and what is most important to me is really the drama of it and expressing, using music to bring these characters to life and bring them to life in a way that we can see ourselves in them. That really, I think, theater, opera is about... it's really about us, and it's really about us finding ways to navigate the challenges and the joys of our own lives. And that was definitely something that we thought very, very long, hard, and deeply about in writing JFK.
Yeah, thank you. I think what is really interesting about the piece, and I hope you'll see, is and what we found as we started living this for the past few years is that they were iconic figures, but also very normal, flawed human beings like we all are, and not being afraid to show that side of them. Mm-hmm. So can you guys talk about a little bit about how you collaborate? Is it, you know, it's not, I know it's not Gilbert and Sullivan where he sends you a script and then you write it and then we do the opera, so.
Well, we talk on the phone like every day. So that's the, like the first thing.
It's good to be best friends,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah, it helps.
Yeah. We literally talk on the phone an embarrassing amount. But we do sort of work in a relatively traditional way in that the libretto does come first. Well, a treatment comes first, and we work very collaboratively and organically on the outline or the treatment.
In kind of a brainstorm session kind of way. We just sort of throw out ideas, see something sticks, something's don't.
Totally. And this was a new, well, actually not, because Vinkensport was an original piece, mm-hmm. but Vinkensport was written in haste.
Yes.
So we had about, I don't know, 2 months from
it's
start
kind of
to
like
finish.
It's kind of like Best in Show, only for Finches.
Yeah. For Finches,
to
yeah.
sort of give you an
yeah.
idea.
Written while Royce was in Canada and I was in Australia, and I think once I got the libretto, I wrote the opera in 5 weeks or something.
Yeah, it was...
I don't ever want to do that again.
But you don't say no to Don Upshaw.
You don't say no to Don Upshaw.
So yeah, we created a treatment, and then we start. I wrote the libretto, and the treatment was one thing, and the first draft of the libretto was another, and the second draft of the libretto evolved even further. It was because it was original. There was a remarkable evolution. We really had to find our way through the piece. But once the libretto, once the sort of compositional draft of the libretto was created, then David went off and started composing. But I'm on call for that whole period. So when we wrote Dog Days, there were moments where David was like, I've written up to this moment, and there is, I think we need an aria here. Mm-hmm. And in JFK, we wrote up to Jack's final aria, and you called me, I was in Philadelphia, and you said, I don't know. I'm not. There's something that's not clicking here, and I don't. And so we are unbelievably thoughtful about every step of the process. But this was a really, really interesting and exciting opportunity where the piece really revealed itself.
I mean, I get a little more kind of hippie about it, where I kind of feel, and increasingly I feel that this piece, whatever piece we're working on, sort of already exists in the universe, and it's our job to discover it and to uncover it, right? And so sometimes we will write things that will be incorrect, you know, that we will, and I think these moments Royce mentioned in Dog Days where we wrote up to a certain point, and for me there was just a feeling that the energy that we need to move, I'm such a hippie now, I don't know what's happening to me, the energy, it felt wrong. The step that we had prescribed initially felt wrong, and we needed to go in a different direction. And there were moments in writing JFK that were very similar. We had to find it together, and so that's a lot of conversation, a lot of discussion about different approaches. The artwork definitely informed this process a lot because we had that to go to. You know, we knew what works of art were in their space, and so if we were stuck, we could say, well, what are the paintings? We have these 16 paintings to look at. A great example of that is there was one moment where we shifted from the swimming hole painting to the Russell in the Snowstorm We Are Friends painting because we were struggling with a dramaturgical problem, and shifting to a different painting revealed a solution to us, you know. And so it's a kind of puzzle that we work on putting together. And even up until the very end, I mean, I had written almost 2 full hours of music, and we realized that there was a moment that was missing. There was a last moment where Jack and Jackie would be together, and that ended up getting written on a bar napkin in Manhattan, you know, where we sat down and we said, we need to find this thing, and we need to do it tonight, because the piece is due in 2 weeks, and what is it gonna be? And, you know, we discovered it.
And just a couple of days ago, we were doing an interview, and we had read the lyrics that that I came up with, that we came up with collaboratively for that particular moment. And they are so simple. It's like 4 lines. And we're like, really, what took us so long? Yeah. Why? Like, this is outrageous struggled so hard to find this moment.
It had to be the right moment. And I think in that process, we probably explored about 25 other moments. Mm-hmm. And we're like, yeah, but that's not quite right. And then we hit on this one and said, okay, this is right, you know. And you have to also sit with it. You write, for me at least, you know, I'll write a scene and then I'll have to ignore it for a couple days and I'll go back to it and almost take it in like I would as an audience member and think, okay, I'm bored here, that's cool, I like that, you know, and then kind of go back in and tinker and make it something that I would as an audience member find consistently engaging and moving.
And it was amazing. We really set out to write a piece that that was both a gift to Fort Worth and also a gift to the larger world, that transcended the time and the experience here. And so I think that the art was sort of that element that allowed us to transcend in many ways and become something that that traveled beyond the local, that became a more expansive universe.
I love that in the libretto, and you'll hear there are just little lyrics or little words that are sort of gifts to those of us who live here. You know, it talks about the stockyards, and there's a line where you will hear in the duet where they say, no faint hearts, and that's a beautiful lyric for everybody in the world, but to those of us in Fort Worth who knows that Kennedy came outside and said, there are no faint hearts in Fort Worth, it was sort of a beautiful little Easter egg, if you will, for the people of Fort Worth. We have a few minutes for some questions from the audience. I think Nathan is around there.
So if anybody...
Oh, there you are.
Hi. There's a question right there, Nate. Right on the, yep.
You alluded to a Western painting that was not made by, but you never told us who it was made by. At least I didn't catch it. One Western piece you said surprisingly, and then went off to something else.
Western art piece?
Yeah, Western
by,
art.
By Charlie Russell.
Okay, thank you.
I might make an observation, if I could, while
go ahead, please.
For a question which occurred to me just a minute ago. I know many of you in the room knew Ruth, but the sort of pop-up quality of a world-class art exhibit just being taken in one day to a hotel room rings true to me about Ruth. You know, if you called her at home, she answered the phone. If you went too long, she just hung up. She was terse and laconic, and she sort of abhorred pretense in a way. And I remember the very first visit to her house, however many years ago that was, we were talking in the dining room, and if you knew the house, Harwell Hamilton Harris, the architect, had finished it in 1957, specifically for Ruth, beautiful little modernist box, and the walls, you know, it's the materials are no pretense either. It was cork floors, the walls were pegboard. So we're talking in the dining room, and there's a Canaletto hanging on pegboard, and the juxtaposition at the surface just didn't seem to make sense, but it's perfect, Ruth. You know, she it didn't bother her at all. They're both quality in their own way in it.
And it's great to hear that the art became so central to your vehicle, because everything was very intentional in what was selected for this pop-up. Mm-hmm. I love it too, because that notion of a pop-up is something that is being recapitulated today. Is an important way that expression and creativity can be experienced momentarily. And Ruth was, I mean, it was happening in Fort Worth at that moment, you know, 50 plus years ago, in a kind of wonderful way. But, you know, the notion, I just think, is fabulous, that the Russell painting was, you know, a work that you found really compelling. And it was one, you know, we are friends. And think about the thing that I thought was really great about this installation too, as a intentional act, was when they walked in, when the president and first lady walked in, the first thing that they encountered was Picasso's angry owl, which I think is this kind of wonderful metaphor potentially about, you know, the differences that exist. And Picasso had become a point of great controversy in Dallas just a few years prior to that. So it was also an embrace that Fort Worth, and I think to Kennedy's point, that art is not about propaganda or politics in an essential way, but it is about truth. And I think that's a quality as well in that larger vision that was happening here in Fort Worth in a really kind of wonderful way.
Well, I love that point about truth. I mean, this is something that we talk about a lot, that, you know, with the saying, art is the lie that tells the truth, you know, and this, and what do we say about to deviate as much from the facts as the truth requires, you know, that there is this sort of greater pursuit that we're after. And I think looking at the Kennedys as human beings in the context of their great responsibility and their great role culturally was really in pursuit of that kind of truth.
Okay.
I was wondering who chose the art for the Kennedy suite? Who chose what went into the...
It was, you know, it was really a matter of three people, I think, that made most of the decisions. Sam Canty, who was very influential at that time as a leader for the Fort Worth Art Association, which is, as George has mentioned, was the precursor to the modern. Ruth, of course, and then her director, Mitch Wilder, who is a force in this. He kind of laid it out, from what I understand, in each of the different rooms. But they were the three individuals that were making the selections relatively quickly. But then there was the Bass family was lending, the Wiener family was lending, the Fuller family was lending at that time. And these were very important collections in Fort Worth. It's something that sometimes gets lost to the significance of private collections that were growing in the city at that particular time.
But one of the things I love, though, is and I can't remember who told me this, but someone who had interviewed the Dallas-based Secret Service agent who was there in the hotel room when Ruth was hanging the paintings, who commented on her taking her shoes off and getting this cute young girl as he referred to her, got up on the bed in her stocking feet to hang the paintings on the wall over the bed, so that there was this sense of a direct engagement. There were no preparators. It wasn't her standing over there saying, please put this over here, please put this over here. No, it was really, she was hammering the nails, which I think is just fantastic.
She probably wanted court.
The question right there.
Yes, this question is for the librettist and the last year, I don't mean to sound just terribly critical because I don't think I can be, but last year when we saw Dog Days, at least on the night that we saw it, a large portion of the audience had walked out. So mine is more like, I didn't know whether it had been more, what success you had elsewhere, and that maybe I'm seeing this Kennedy piece as redemption, and maybe I don't know if I'm going to hear the F word a lot like we did in Dog Days. I'm sorry.
I can assure you that Dog Days has had amazing runs. We just actually opened two new productions in Germany, and we've traveled to LA, and we just had a sold-out run in New York, and so I'm sorry that it didn't communicate to the audience here in Fort Worth, or to some of the audience in Fort Worth. But I think that JFK is a whole new thing, and I hope that you come with an open mind, I don't know how to respond to that.
I'll take it.
Good.
I think we are, in some ways, first and foremost, storytellers. And the way we tell stories is through theater and through music. And stories are different. Different stories require different things, So a great example is that Dog Days, we felt very strongly that the aesthetic world of Dog Days was an amplified sound world, whereas JFK is unamplified. It's grand opera with orchestra and, acoustic singing. So, and that is because of what the story required. So we always start with the story and what we need to tell that story in the most honest way we can. And that's how we work. That's where we always start.
Perhaps you've just answered this in part, but my take was from a different perspective. In the works of art that were in that room, every artist had such a unique way of expressing himself, I think it was all himself, that you would know the works by that artist almost without being told who created what. And you have experience now as contemporary composers and collaborators over some period of time. And I was wondering if there is a sound that is your sound, or do you approach each work in a different way?
I think my music definitely sounds like my music, and I think Royce's words definitely sound like Royce's words. And especially having worked with him for so long, I could point out a couple special quirks that I really love that he comes back to, and I'm sure he could do the same thing with me. I mean, I think for me, it's sort of on the level of the DNA. The way I put notes together is consistent piece to piece. And again, going back to this question of story, sometimes there's the father's aria in Dog Days is very angry and very angular. The material we're about to hear from Daniela and Matt is not that. It's expressing a very different thing. I think if you looked at it closely, there would be a lot of things actually similar between them in terms of harmony, melody, rhythm, things like that. But again, they're different stories. So I think this definitely sounds like us. And I think the way that we approach this story is a way that this is a story that no other team would write. This is our version of this story that really came from a lot of thought and a lot of careful consideration, but another team would write a different story.
One more before we hear some music, anybody?
And that's not a question, but about Dog Days, I thought it was phenomenal. I saw it in community center and was quite, maybe very truthful, very somewhat disturbing, but at the same time, I think it showed the degradation step by step of human being faced with difficult conditions. So I think it was, in that sense, I think it was one of a kind, really unique. And I don't remember anybody walking in, maybe a couple of people, because it was just difficult to endure such, I guess, truth maybe, naked truth. And it reminded me of Dostoevsky a little bit, you know, just the degradation process. Yeah. So I thought it was phenomenal, so thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, you're now gonna get to hear a couple of numbers from the show, and the first one is a duet. When we imagine Jack and Jackie meeting for the first time, do you want to talk a little bit about, you look familiar?
Yeah, so this is a two-part scene, You Look Familiar and Written on the Palm. And
I'm going to do the next one.
Oh, you're going to do the next one. Okay, so I got this one. All right. And so when we see Jack and Jackie meet for the first time, one of the things we really thought a lot about is what is the audience's interaction as citizens of the world with Jack and Jackie. And something that felt very important was that, you know, they were this sort of great legendary couple. What if we could see them meet for the first time? What would that be like? And so in our telling of the story, this meeting happens in a dreamscape by the Sea of Serenity on the moon. And Jack has a series of sort of trials that he goes through and gets through the other side and sees this beautiful young woman sunbathing on the moon and goes up and works his charm. And what I love about this scene and what was so satisfying for us to work with in the scene is that we get to see the entire course of their courtship from the very beginning to the point where they are completely a unit and moving into the world together in about 6 minutes. Something that only theater and opera can really do.
As JFK Matt Worth, as Jackie Daniela Mack, and as our fabulous orchestra, Emily Urbanek.
Quite love your imagination.
And Royce, would you set up this aria for Jackie?
Gladly. Even from the initial treatment, the first thing we put down to paper, I knew that I wanted to write a scene where Jackie woke up in the middle of the night or hadn't slept yet, but it was in the middle of the night, and she came and communicated something to Jack, because I just loved that we had these unaccounted for hours. And so this is the manifestation of that desire on my part. And here is Jackie, who has, the Secret Service agent has pulled Jack. He's fallen asleep in the bathtub, and she has, she's had the Secret Service agent lay him in the bed, and she is laying beside him, and she is telling him that she is recommitting to him and his campaign and to their life together. And so...
he's asleep.
He is
right?
asleep.
He's not conscious at this point. until a certain moment when he becomes conscious. And then we see that he's listening.
We call this You Shiver.
Thank you.
Thanks, Daniela, Matt, and Emily. Thanks so much. The Kimbell is our gracious host tonight, and there is a wonderful reception right after this in the upstairs. I'd like to thank again the 6-4 Museum, the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation, Opera America, and our fabulous panelists. Thank you, guys. We'll see you upstairs.